Christian state and extremism. With the guests, some of you already got to know, and the others are going to be introduced in a minute. Before we start talking about fine theoretical world-critical things, let me just give you the structure of this event. So all of our six presenters are going to be here in 10 minutes or so. I'm not going to track the time this time, because we have 2 hours. And then after they finish their 10 minutes presentations, I will open the floor for the audience. I hope that you are going to have questions and that we are really engaged in discussion. If not, I will be here to do that for you, but please feel free to think of some possible questions so that discussion begins 1 hour after the presentation. That much about the structure of the event. Now I'm going to start my very short introduction with one, I think, adequate passage from Anthony Smith's book, written in 1997. The book was Nationalism and Modernity. I think it's a very, very important one and a proper one for this kind of conversation at the conference we're on. I think that the name of Anthony Smith was also mentioned a couple of times today, maybe also yesterday. So Anthony Smith is with us in a way. What he did say in his introduction to this book, written in 1997, and I think it's worth emphasizing again in the year when it was published, is this. So he says, a single red line traverses the history of the modern world from the fall of the Bastille to the fall of the Berlin Wall. The name of the red line is nationalism, and its story is the central thread binding and dividing the peoples of the modern world. The story of its progress is one of the emergence and decline, the rise and fall of nations and nationalisms. After its apogee in the two world wars, nationalism is now beginning to decline and give way to global forces which transcend the boundaries of nation state. I cannot say which of the words I would love to emphasize more, especially this last sentence seems to me very intriguing 20 years after this book was written and published. So I would wish to draw your attention to only 2 things now. The first thing is that the idea that nation state is in decline. Obviously, in 1997, somebody as huge, as relevant for this kind of theorizing as Anthony Smith, thought that nation state and nationalism are in decline. Eric Fasson, our very great friend, who is unfortunately not with us tonight, so this is a way to also invoke him in this conversation, said 10 days ago that in the 90s, there was this one political discursive alternative. Either you are for nation or you are for Europe, if you were a European at the time. So that was the either or. You were for nation state or you were somehow against nation state and for European Union or European values. And then he said that in 2005, this changed dramatically with the referendums in the EU, first in France, but in other countries as well, when there was a shift of the paradigm where suddenly, all of a sudden, you could have been for Europe, for more Europe, being at the same time for more nation. This is Fasson's wording of the thing, so not either or, not Europe or nation, but more Europe and more nation. Which in Fasson's wording also brought more neoliberalism plus more xenophobia, which I think is relevant for our topic of extremism tonight. The second thing I would like to emphasize from the Anthony Smith's passage, is the idea the fall of Berlin Wall marked the decline of the nation state. It also seems relevant that now, almost 13 years after the fall of the Berlin Wall, we have to think and rethink again the divisions that are now lost or those that remained or the new ones that are being created in the Europe that we are now facing. I'm stopping here. I want to introduce very briefly our presenters tonight, and then to give them the word. So, Ljubica Spasovska comes from the University of Exeter, UK. Jovo Bakić, saying that everyone knows Jovo Bakić here, comes from the Faculty of Philosophy, Sociology Department, University of Belgrade. Rigels Halili, one of friends, great friends, comes from the Center for East European Studies at the University of Warsaw. Tamás comes from the CEU, but not only from the CEU, University of Budapest. He's a great intellectual and as well a friend of the Group for Social Engagement Studies in the Institute. Then Monserrat Guibernau, or am I pronouncing it right? Please.
It's all right. There's a variety of...
comes from University of Cambridge, one of our keynote lecturers at this conference. And finally, Nebojša Vladisavljević, former colleague of mine, and there is Faculty of Political Sciences, University of Belgrade.
Thank you so much. It's a real privilege to be here with this esteemed colleagues. Since you mentioned 1989, which has been usually portrayed in the literature as the annus mirabilis of great change as a juncture, critical juncture in recent history, the project I'm part of at the University of Exeter is called 1989 after 1999, the rethinking of the fall of state socialism and a global perspective. So one of our big questions we're trying to tackle is indeed how to dethrone 1989 and how to decenter 1989. Recent historiography has produced excellent work, not least Jacques Rupnik's edited volume on 1989 as a world political event. So to start my short presentation, I think I want to depart from this premise that in order to understand Europe of today, and especially the rise of extreme right politics, we need to place Europe in a wider global context and to look perhaps at the repercussions of 1989 further away from the strictly European realm. So what many historians and political scientists have argued, indeed I agree with that, is that 1989 has been underpinned by a sense of Western liberal triumphalism, which in a way isolated immediately large sections of the populations in the post-socialist space and created in a way led to the creations of specific hegemonic mnemonic regimes where our member socialism was shaped in a certain way, especially through initiatives of castrations, creations of institutes for the crimes of communism, and most recently, of course, declarations and initiatives at the European Union level of commemorations of crimes of communism and the two totalitarianism theses of, in a way, equating Stalinism and Nazism. I have in mind the 23rd of August day as a day of commemoration of the victims of both totalitarianisms. So I will come back to this, but let me talk about the importance again of placing Europe in a broader perspective. There has been a recent book which has really caused a lot of stir, especially among historians, called Eurafrica, The Untold Story of European Integration and Colonialism, by two Swedish historians, Pia Hansen and Stefan Jonsson, where they talk about Eurafrica and the project of European integration, which started, of course, in the 1920s, but especially in the post-World War II history of European colonialism, as forgotten and left out of the story of European integration. So their argument is basically that the Union, or the community at the time, would not come into existence in the 1950s Had it not been conceived as a Eurafrican enterprise in which colonialism was Europeanized or reformed and improved, etc., and that some countries, and France especially at this point, of course, with the war in Algeria, sought to strengthen its grip on Africa through its assets and resources. So I think it is very important when we're talking about extremism, especially homegrown extremism in Europe, in France especially, that we bear in mind that all of this has its prehistory. Again, I keep emphasizing this, that the Algerian war produced certainly a set of narratives, communities with their own traumas, etc. So it, in a way, it also helps us to escape the basically the imagining only of the Balkans as a space of instability and trauma and conflict, etc. That's one point. Second point, I think, especially living in Britain and the British media, how they were reporting, and the BBC, which I have great respect for as one of the last standing public services, bastions of public broadcasting in Europe. Nevertheless, they often omitted to reflect on the fact where these refugees were coming from and why they were flooding the coast of Europe. Syrians, of course, were in the focus of attention, but no one talked explicitly about the Afghanis and Iraqis. Why Afghanistan and Iraq, still today, after so many years, after interventions, are still producing instability and flows of refugees. So again, something which has been silenced and which I think is very important. So in my mind and in my understanding then, if we can pinpoint a certain year where, let's say, a new world order came into being, it would be 1986, when America for the first time, the US at the time, decided to bomb in an act of revenge an independent country, which was Libya, in revenge for the killing or for, of course, it was state terrorism, but for the terrorist attack in Berlin, where one US serviceman was killed. So, at this occasion, the US president said, we will always defend American citizens wherever they are, and we have to move them in the future. So I think in this sense, 86 also coincided with Soviet perestroika and glasnost. It's really, I think, and also with the huge skyrocketing rates of debt in the developing world, not least Yugoslavia, inflation, I think is the turning point in this story about the rise of neoliberalism in extreme politics. The view that developing countries pioneered, and here I put Yugoslavia, although Yugoslavia is usually put in the basket with Eastern European countries, but Yugoslavia had a very distinct identity, even as a third world country, especially in forums such as the United Nations. So the argument was that if you keep investing and aiding the development of the third world, this benefits the industrialized developed countries as well. And the whole debate in the 70s about giving 0.9% of GDP as aid to developing countries, etc., would really contribute to the stability and the prosperity of the West. So this is again, in my opinion, one missed opportunity, that real, genuine investment in the development of the third world was not achieved for a variety of reasons. We can't go into that now. Of course, there was a responsibility of domestic elites. But again, these regions around Europe, the Middle East and North of Africa, not to say Sub-Saharan Africa, of course, the failed development of these regions produces and will keep producing instability in the future. Now, I just want to mention perhaps as a footnote, an article by a German-American economic historian and sociologist, Andrew Günther Frank, who has been very controversial, of course, and he passed away, but he wrote an article in 1991 called The Third World War, A Political Economy of the Gulf War and the New World Order, talking about, of course, the Iraqi Kuwait conflict and the intervention again of the US. So, because very often now we hear that we have a third world war going on in Syria. But again, I think we have to think backwards and think about how the Middle East again became this completely fragmented space which had the potential and was on the path of secularization and development, etc. But with the unfortunate combination of authoritarian leaders and external intervention, now, unfortunately, as Frank says, these places were bombed back into pre-modernity, unfortunately. Finally, to come back to our contemporary context, we have seen populism, as Professor Guibernau mentioned today, populism feeding on economic grievances, on austerity policies, and on the widening income gap, which Piketty has very well researched and talked publicly on several occasions. So in the recent referendum on Brexit, it was very obvious that economic grievances were fused with concerns about immigration, and that the wide dispossessed working class, which, again, I would say, our region is not very unique in that sense. Deindustrialization happened across Western Europe, and Britain is a perfect example of that. There are areas of small British towns which were mining towns which were prosperous because of their steel industry, which are completely abandoned today in terms of production and industry, and which just house people, as I said, whose grievances feed on concerns about immigration. So for me as an outsider, it was striking to see that there were no articulations of any solidarity, which was there during the miners' strike in 1984-85, when the entire European space resonated with the British miners' strike. There were Danish bombs bringing aid, etc. And somehow I was secretly hoping that the British workers would march to Brussels and demand a better social Europe, but no. Instead, they turned against Polish bakers, Polish plumbers, etc. And the most unfortunate thing, of course, not least the murder of John Cox, an MP, in a broad daylight on a British street, which, as we said, would have been unimaginable 5 years ago, happened. But also an extremely rapid rise in racist incidents in Britain. So, again, I think we have to look at Europe as a space which needs a common approach and not just balkanizing the Balkans or talking about the balkanization of Europe. So, did I already?
Yes, I mean,
yeah, okay, I'll stop here and perhaps we can answer some questions.
Well, I would like to connect the theme of the return of national borders with the theme we discussed on Sunday and three other returns. The return of inequality, return of biology, and return of sacred. I would like to connect all these issues because I think they are closely connected. Although Rogers Brubaker mentioned these returns of inequality, biology, and sacred in relation with scholarly work. Scholarly work is not isolated from social reality. And as Ljubica mentioned before, in 1990 we faced a kind of anti-communist triumphalism. And certainly socialism was authoritarian. Obviously, it wasn't democratic, really existing socialism. However, could we consider capitalism as intrinsically democratic? This question would be quite a silly one before 1941, 1939, before the Second World War. If you read Great Transformation written by Karl Polan, you will see that at this time, capitalism was intrinsically non-democratic. So people could be very surprised to see in 1990 that the triumph of capitalism was celebrated as a triumph of democracy. Because these things are not the same. On the contrary, they are quite opposite. The only period that one kind of capitalism approached democracy was the welfare state period. Three glorious decades till the oil crisis in 1973. And the offensive of neoliberalism, and I would remind you that Jean-Marie Le Pen said in 1983 that he was neoliberal 2 years before Ronald Reagan. And it is true. In the first program of Front National, you will see neoliberal economic program. So before Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher. And what Jean-Marie Le Pen inherited from Alain de Benoit, it was idea of Christian Europe. And by the way, Alain de Benoit is an enemy of Christian. However, he thought that Christianity is a useful idea that could make a difference between Islamic world, communist world, and Christian world, where Christianity is a matter of identity and not a matter of religiosity. So, comeback of sacred was anticipated by the far right. And Alain de Benoist introduced idea given firstly by Anglo-Saxon that cultural hegemony is extremely important if you want to win political power. So firstly, you should win cultural battle, and afterwards, you will achieve your political goals. And indeed, Alain de Benoist is today very well respected academic in France. And daughter of Jean-Marie, Marine Le Pen, is at this very moment the most popular politician in France. So cultural hegemony was won before successful political struggle. And who were first members of Front National? Various fascist, national revolutionary groups, Nazi groups, and ultra-conservative Catholic groups. This broad coalition was gathered by Jean-Marie Le Pen, and Ljubica mentioned Algerian war. It is extremely important. Million people lost their lives during the Algerian war. And what Jean-Marie Le Pen did, he was parachuter, volunteer, lieutenant in the Legion of Fighters. He said that he killed some war prisoners, and afterwards, when he was attacked as a war criminal, he said, no, it's a leftist conspiracy. Why do I talk about it? Because I think that this return of separate biology, inequality, it has been caused by nature of capitalism. Capitalism was able to control itself because of communist, so-called communist threat. Without communist threat, it is liberated. Quotation mark, liberated. So we can behave in a way we want. And if you read the Federalist Papers, you will see that first founders of American democracy as we know them right now were enemies of democracy. They are explicitly enemies of democracy. Not only that Thomas Jefferson was a slave owner, but they criticized the democratic idea. And the whole political system in the United States was based on idea of liberalism, not on idea of democracy. They're not the same things. But after the Second World War, because of authoritarian nature of socialist systems, it was easy to transform originally oligarchic system in so-called democracy. And when today we face demagogic appeals of the far right, they found an easy target: deficit of democracy, democratic deficit. That's the problem in all Europe as well as in the United States of America. Ordinary citizens are not asked. Oligarchy is asked. And it is an easy target. The problem is that democracy, I would say always under quotation marks, far-right democracy, would be at best ethnocracy, at best. Probably it would be kind of authoritarian system, but under the label of democracy. And we see right now, we face right now, Viktor Orban in Hungary, Erdogan in Turkey, Alexander Vučić here. There are several manifestations of authoritarianism. They are different among themselves. But as you notice, for Putin in Russia, they are in pretty good mutual relations. They learn from each other. And unfortunately, I'm a pessimist. I think it is a broader, deeper far-reaching trend. So nationalism is an instrument for capitalist competition. People see, so Burj Khalifa, tower in Dubai, the tallest in the world. Okay, let's have our own tower here in Belgrade, Belgrade Waterfront. Shopping mall, the largest in the world in Dubai. Let's have one here, Belgrade Waterfront. It would be largest in the Balkans. It is time for national pride because we do not have other kinds of pride. And that is the problem of capitalist society and so-called democracy. And you see ethno-pluralism, ideological benchmark of far right. It is based on authoritarian xenophobic nationalism as a core of the far right ideology. And ethno-pluralism, what does it really mean? It means, no, we are not racist. No, we are not. We just don't want to mix with others. So it is cultural racism, isn't it? And today, with all these mixtures of inequality, biology, sacred, we will see that it is the very same thing. And I suppose that I talked too much.
Okay, Adriana, thank you for trying to be. Did you clap for Ljubica or not?
There is a applause for Ljubica.
Okay, I will start by saying what is my standpoint. Standpoint from which point I talk about this issue. And first of all, I'm not a specialist on France. I'm not going to say anything about Marine Le Pen or France. I've been living in Britain. I've been living in Albania, Poland. So I will speak from, I will speak from this Central European, largely spoken Central European point of view. And I will start with a very short story which showed, or actually made me an extremist because of national borders. And this was when I was refused twice to get a visa, an entry visa, by two countries that are dear to me, Greece and UK. Greece on the ground that I remain an illegal immigrant in Greece. Although I have a permanent resident in Poland, it doesn't matter. UK, on the same ground that I would remain as an illegal immigrant after living 3 years, having a permanent job in Poland, and having a visa, whatever. Now, it was at that point that it's a turning point. When you become an extremist in personal way, you take it personally, or you become an extremist on a national basis. Those bastards do not like us. And I was an Albanian citizen then, I'm still an Albanian citizen, and in that sense, it was I took it personally in terms of national pride. You, mother, whatever. Now, why I'm saying this? Because in every, as I understand extremism, in every extremism there is an emotion, a sentiment, which turns into a norm. And let's take the theme, the topic of our meeting. So we and break it to point into questions. So where in Europe the extremism is rising? What kind of extremism is rising? And where are these national borders located? Are they frontiers? Do they correspond with national borders, nation state borders, or nations are divided between the two, or perhaps there are boundaries? On national criteria, not or frontiers even, and frontiers in terms of larger entities than nation states. Well, nowhere in Europe at the moment extremists are in power. I would say, no, but even Putin is not an extremist. Stalin is not an extremist. Putin is not. So let's not use words so easily. Because language matters when we speak about this kind of stuff. What I mean by extremism is that it's total exclusion of the otherness, in the sense that we don't mix at all with others. Total exclusion. And also essentializing and homogenizing otherness. This for me it's extremism. There are areas in Europe where we can see a growing sentiment and even a movement. And this is definitely Central Europe, facing economic crisis or the migrant crisis. I will talk about that. This is definitely not in Poland but also Austria. This is the Balkans extremism, or this kind of essentializing otherness and ourness, never left our corners. And to our surprise, the UK. I'm not going to say anything about Trump. The guy is building walls, so we'll see how it goes. Now, why extremism? Why this extremism arises? I wanted to touch on this issue. It's not simple, but I gave a thought about it. So I would mention the first credit would be the economic crisis of 2008 that changed everything. We started talking about capitalism as the evil after 2008. Before that, we were having a large party, we were drinking a lot. Now we are having enough. It's the after party. It's going worse and worse in the after part. We're not chilling out. So economic crisis and the divisions it has created in various countries in Europe. And this extremism arises from the protest against the social order, the political order, the economic order. And there is the second, in my opinion, the second major cause of extremism is migration crisis. This extremism arises from fear. It's not only protest, it's a different type, but it's from fear. Whether it's real or imagined, it's a matter of discussion. But it also arises also from this feeling of threat. Now, I live in Poland, and there are no Arab people in Poland, but I don't know why Polish people show a high level of feeling threatened by the Arab people. Understand that, but that is the reason. The third, and also a major point, which also it's more tackles also, basically tackles Central Europe and Eastern Europe, is the cost of post-communist transformation. It's the unfinished revolution, James Mark used the term, the contesting of the neoliberal path. It left a lot of unsolved problems. And also it left behind a lot of lost souls, as I call them. It's the consequence of the vacuum of ideas, but also the vacuum of security that brings up this extremism. That is, it's based on the cost of post-communism cost of transformation in Central Europe. What kind of extremism we are facing with? And I will start with the extremism that is dear to me, which is the left-wing extremism. We are talking so much about the right-wing, we are forgetting about the left-wing extremism. And I urge you not to forget about that. Because if there is a civil war in Syria, it's still not the civil war of Spain. We are not in third war, but it might be. In a different way, but it might have the same impact as the civil war of Spain. In our poor old rich continent. So the left-wing extremism in Central Europe, due to the fall of communism, remains in the margins. It was pushed into the margins by the center-left. The center-left wanted to be democratic, left nationalism, nation side, social element. It's the shift, and it's a shift from the working class to the working people that drives this kind of extremism. It's an extremism that is, or it's a set of ideas that is an expanding perspective from local, national, towards global threats. And it's an extremism that we spoke about biology the other day, Sunday. it's an extremism, or it's a set of ideas that put a stress on ecology, not on biology. Who is the enemy of this left-wing extremism? It's always capitalism. It's in a way that it's a right-wing and capitalism, which is good. And the global corporations. Yes, let's not forget about that. What is the activity of this extremism? Well, it's not anarchical. They are not throwing bombs, but it's a positivist working from the basis, getting ground little by little. And there is also, well, of course, also the extreme right, which it seeks, and probably, and I guess it has succeeded, to come back from the margins. It was put by the Cold War division between the capitalism and communism. So it comes back. It's a process that is getting stronger and stronger, and it comes and it shifts from the fascist, although it relates to fascism, towards this national-centered perspective, nationalist, or even more, I'd say even more than national. It's nationalized perspective. The only valid people for this group, as I see it, is the nation. There are no other. The will of the nation gives the power. This is pretty much returning to the 30s, the way to the 20s, as I see it. The global threat is threatening, first of all, the nation. It has a local impact. These people, and I met some of them in Warsaw, interviewed them, they don't think globally, they think locally. Very much locally. For them, there is no such thing as climate change. There is no ecology, there is only genetics and biology. And this is a stress about it. Citizenship, in this case, is not signed by ink or with ink, it's signed with blood. The enemy is everyone who is against them. And I use a picture of these followers of Legia football team of in Warsaw, who actually have their motto is, we hate everyone. It's not like partisans, we hate everyone. That's their motto. Just everyone. And the activity, the way they are, is revolutionary by nature. And that is what is actually worrying. Now, Raymond Aron, who is very dear to me, distinguished in his old book, and I urge you to read it once again, The Open of Intellectuals, he distinguished two lefts between the right left, the extreme left, and the social democrat left. And he said that the extreme left is winning in France, is leaving aside the social democrat left, is becoming more and more visible. He wrote this in 1953, common French communism at the time was very on top, it was creme de la creme. And I would say that we have two rights nowadays. We are facing with two rights in the world. There is the extreme right and there is the center right. The center right and the extreme right are fighting with each other for legitimacy. But it's going to be I guess probably you can discuss with them or not. And they have different divisions, they have different features, each one of them. One is more conservative, the other one is more populist, the other one is traditional, the other one is heritage, and so on and so forth. I have sort of a typology here. This is not the point. The point is that they are fighting for legitimacy. And it's a legitimacy that everywhere in Europe, as I can see, it's definitely in our corner of the world. It's a dialogue that might end with the beginning of a new authoritarian regime in our corner, if the right wing wins, or with nevertheless the losing of this center perspective. Because and this is visible in the way the migration crisis has been tackled in Central Europe. First of all, for whom it is a crisis? Second of all, it's not a migration crisis, it's a humanitarian crisis. And third, the shift from human to migrant, the language here, is crucial. Because it makes us not to relate to people's perspective, not to relate to this experience. We forget about them. They are not human, they are migrants. They are just getting drowned out there. But they are migrants. We don't know how to call them. Refugees, migrants, immigrants. Have you noticed this? There is a cacophony of terms. It's a humanitarian crisis. That's it. What to do with it? What to do with all of this that is happening in our corner? Ooh. That is tough. The toughest question for the end. Well, as I said, the times are not normal. Let us act normally, but let us not forget that there is need to raise the voice, because if we don't speak for the others, then in the end nobody will speak for us.
Thank you.
Right, I think that it belongs to our dignity as losers in this world of historical conflict that's going on to recognize without any hypocrisy and any false lightheartedness and the ironical thing that is so dear to me in other occasions, but it's a dark moment of history. There's a very, very deep conflict in the political world where the left and the camp of democracy is losing every day. And I'm not very much interested, you will excuse me, what labels we paste on these semi-dictators today, extremists, not all, they may not be extremists. Why should they be extremists? Nobody is resisting them. You know, they can be perfectly sweet and okay, because everything is going smoothly for them. They will be much less pleasant if we will be more humorous, which doesn't seem to be on the agenda at the moment. So, you know, I'm coming from Hungary, where, you know, everybody has given up and, hoisting the white flag. And a few crazies still fighting, okay? But where you have approval rates of these most racist politics, you know, 86%, 92%, and such like. And because there's no resistance, it's not because my compatriots are evil, they're not. Well, they can be, of course, in a deep shit where they all are, they can be convinced to go down the old path. So now, that was the introduction. Now for the substantive issues. Whoever said that nationalism was in decline was right. What we have today is not nationalism. What we have today is ethnicism, as I described in my writings. Just to give you a familiar and banal example, what was the main content of nationalism in the classical century of nationalism, 19th? What was the aim of nationalism of marginal small nations of Eastern Europe? For example, of the Southern Slavs. What was it? Illyrism. You know, union of Southern Slavs. The content of old Serb and Croat nationalism is not to get apart, but to get together, right? The nation was consciously in Italy, in Germany, in Southern Slavs, etc., etc., was pieced together from fragments, you know, small principalities, ethnic groups, this and that and the other. And to a certain extent, this was also the case of the Soviet Union, but don't tell anybody. It was the creation of a nation state that, of course, was in today's sense internationalism. Because nationalism is not racism, and nationalism is not ethnicism. When the development of capitalism, and of course, the end of the Cold War is an aspect of this, because you see, there were two versions of the welfare state. The democratic version in Western Europe and the undemocratic version in Eastern Europe. Both were not socialisms. Either wasn't. They were societies that believed in the raising of the living standards, in more earthly comforts, more hygiene, and more equality, and a society of peaceful consumers. equal autonomous as far as it goes, but not too much, okay? And those were destroyed, and with them, the only democratic state form, the capitalism, I agree with you, capitalism was able to live together with. Now, the total horizon is filled with capitalism. There's nothing else. Somebody called it liberate. Yeah. Yes, capitalism is now free to be itself. Daniel Bell, good old conservative, in 1964, has written in his seminal, excellent book, The Cultural Contradictions of Capitalism, that the culture of capitalism was anti-capitalist, that it was an adversary culture that gave it, i.e. liberal, I mean really liberal and really democratic capitalism, gave its flavor, but all the intellectuals were against it. Where there was a terrific cultural conflict at the core of capitalist democratic politics. Well, now this has come to an end. Now, we still have, of course, the diversity of culture, thank you for inviting me to this nice conference. There is some diversity of culture, but of course it's weakened, and for the first time in history, it is seen by its would-be recipients as elite. Isn't that fantastic? We've got considered to be elitists, people who care about emancipation, liberation, and equality, now and are on the side of the downtrodden, of the exploited, the oppressed. It's considered to be elitist. Why? Just think about it. Why do our enemies, let's give them a thought, why do our enemies call us elitists? What is lacking in the cultural and philosophical makeup of the left that makes people to think that they are out of touch, that we are not really addressing the real world? Well, we are not racists. That's why. Being in touch with the human condition today means giving up any kind of emancipatory politics of the bourgeois kind and of the communist kind, both, and to think that belonging to human groups can have only a racial, biological, and cultural determination that doesn't allow of any liberty. And it is the group conformism that seems the only authentic commodity on the political market. And criticizing whatsoever, this is what one of the main enemies is, of course, political correctness. If you read the right-wing press, you may know that. Why? Because political correctness is an educational tool that tells you that you are misbehaving. You are not calling things by their right names. You are impolite, mal élevé, you know? And so therefore, you know, this is the posture of the teacher. And then the left has the other worst posture, namely the posture of the person who offers moral reproaches to its conversation partners. Basically, people feel in this situation today, and I know from my personal experience, because that's what I'm doing, preaching to the unconverted, that it seems to them that what I am telling them is that you are a bad man. In this, I talk endlessly about this refugee crisis in Hungary. And indeed, I have said in the heat of television debate, I said once that, have you no heart? There's a fatal sentence, well, that's what I think, but this is not what you should be employed in public debate. Because, of course, it was not an argument, it was an appeal to the moral judgment of the viewers to condemn him as a bad man. And we are in the position of an unsuccessful, grumbling moralist reproaching people for behaving as they see fit, as they see that is the natural way. And okay, so that's the description of one side of the defeat. And what we are witnessing is the disappearance of all the educational and civilizational tools, because capitalism is losing its political dimension, including that of the nation. In classical nationalism, if you read Fichte, if you read Renan, that a colleague of ours has spoken about these days, to be a German in Fichte's sense, to be a Frenchman in Renan's sense, is to be elevated, is to be worthy of a condition, of a peculiar and of a specific condition, a universal human condition, but still it has to be the best. A real nationalist wants to believe that he's the member of the best community. By what do you measure goodness and bestness and so on? You measure it by criteria of universal morality. And this is the difference between nationalism and ethnicism, is the difference between nationalism and racism, and this is the difference between democratic nationalism and fascism.
Hello, good evening. Thank you very much for inviting me to be here with you today, this privilege. I just have 3 points to make. I'll be brief because I think it'll be very interesting to hear the voice of many of you who are also in the audience. The first question that we were discussing before starting this was about the relevance of the nation. I consider the nation as a community of faith. I know that there are different views, a view that's conservative and a view that is progressive. And I would say that the nation is not in decline. On the contrary, the nation, I think, is becoming very important and being redefined to fit different objectives and different purposes that in some occasions are one in a clash with the other. The decline of nationalism has brought up division, and there is a connection between this decline of nationalism and the rise of the radical right. We've heard some colleagues talking about ethno-pluralism, and it's true. And ethno-pluralism, I regard as a response to what some people define as too much diversity, as a position which is anti-immigration, as a position that is citizens first, and a position that has a connection with the United States of America, because this view of the radical right is actually expanding, has already expanded to the US. And this view that I've been briefly mentioning to you also considers or also takes place and develops in wealthy countries. So let's not be fooled, it's not the poor that are beginning to have these ideas, but it's people that are still relatively wealthy within the system. The other question is, what about the impact of modernity? Is it relevant or not? I think that modernity, and within the idea of cosmopolitanism, became very fashionable a few years ago, but this is no longer the case. Because modernity, we can study and analyze in books, in sociology books, for example, but the idea of cosmopolitanism has been transformed by the different events that we have seen in different countries. Events and substantial transformations, for example, migration. I think that's an important one. Point number too. There was the idea about the fall of the Berlin Wall and the decline of not of the nation state. Well, I think that actually the decline of the nation state did not take place, and I think that the fall of the Berlin Wall contributed to the circulation of ideas, circulation of people within different parts in Europe. And for a while, it really transformed the political and the social landscape. In terms of extremism, that has been also mentioned today, I agree in the fact that we've got an anti-immigrant feeling that's becoming stronger and stronger, especially if the immigrant looks different from us, smells different from us, has different shoes, or maybe doesn't even have shoes, and is kind of uncomfortable to sit next to. These are some of the things that we can trace back in this upsurge of what I call as the radical right. But I would say that this extremism, what it's doing is searching for a golden age, an age that's over, that's in the past. And it is for us to construct, to build the future. I think it's important to have this view. It may not be posh, it may not be elegant, but if we have to leave, we better get our act together and decide how we do it in a way in which we can share and we can move forward. And the point number three that I have the idea that what's the problem? If the other is too different, the more different that the other is, the easier it is to ignore him or her. Because when the other is so alien, so different, that we don't even consider him or her an equal. Or maybe in some instances a human being, and this is serious stuff. Because we can surely and quickly shift from one position to the other. So whatever we do today is going to transform. There is a payback for all this. Lack of solidarity is something that affects us all, because we are all likely to experience time when we will need someone else's solidarity. Think about that. I think it changes some of the preconditions or presuppositions. And I would say that at present we seem to be in the search of a golden past that it doesn't exist anymore, and that opens the opportunity to create something else, something different. This would be my idea of progressiveness, without making it strictly associated to any political ideology. I think that progressiveness as an attitude, as improving life chances, as improving politics, as improving the possibility of living together, this is what I would say, I would think. And my greatest concern, and with this in finish, so that we can move on, is that the return of authoritarian politics, I see very, very close. I see it as imminent. And I feel that we not need only talk about it, but maybe take it seriously and take some measures, or at least to consider where authoritarianism, authoritarian politics could lead us. For me, this is a great danger, because if we make a mistake and we think, well, doesn't matter, it's okay, nothing happens, we may find ourselves in a pretty difficult situation in the future. But that's my view. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I'll try to explain briefly why for once our region only responded to doing better than Western Europe. Admittedly, in a very narrow sense, from the perspective of the topic of our own table. And I'll try to illustrate this by referring to recent developments in the United Kingdom and our region, Bosnia, Croatia, and Serbia. Regarding the UK, it's about Brexit or secession of the UK from the European Union. And when it comes to our region, it's not recent developments surrounding the referendum in the room discussed from part of Bosnia, and also recent parliamentary elections in Croatia. So, if you look at the process, you will see that due to Brexit, this is essentially about a peaceful, orderly, democratic campaign for leave and remain, which cut across mainstream political parties, which involved many more people than kind of standard parliamentary election campaigns involved, because it was about the important issue. Okay, if you talk to passionate observers of British politics, it was not about a normal sort of politics in the UK. There was a rising racism in the grassroots. Ljubica mentioned the killing of the Labour MP. This was indirectly related to the campaign. And still, if you take a step back and look at the British politics, in comparison with the politics in other democratic countries, you will see that it was really a democratic campaign. Not much different from the campaign that surrounded the Scotland's independence referendum. And then, if you look at what happened here in the region, it is exactly the opposite. Recently, we heard that one was mainly called the other one, Gaddafi, and it ended up with a few other. And the other one, if you like, in kind, there were calls for the use of arms, and the others would say they were defending themselves. If you look at the Croatian parliamentary campaign, all kinds of recriminations between government opposition leaders in Croatia and Serbia. This campaign kind of unfolded in the media, ordering of terrorism, and it was to some extent also resonant at a mass level. So if you parachuted an outsider to the region, probably the guy would think that the war is imminent and drown the cover. And yet, if you look at outcomes of all this, you would see that they were exactly different. If you look at what happened with Brexit, it actually has produced, and perhaps it's more precise to say that it will produce a major change, major reconfiguration of national space in Western Europe. It will strongly affect the political and economic development of the UK, and may even trigger all kinds of other problems when it comes to Scotland, and it will affect negatively the peace agreement in Northern Ireland by creating a hard border where there was a soft border between the Republic of Ireland and Northern Ireland. It create all kinds of uncertainties within the European Union, perhaps trigger all kinds of other secession referenda. But in any case, major change is going on there. If you look at our region, nothing much will come out of all this heated campaign working on chauvinism. I think the outcomes will be actually negligible. Parliamentary campaign in Croatia is already over, and we have seen simply a drop in this recrimination between the leaders. This referendum over Vukasinska occurred 2 days ago, and it's already clear that not too much will actually change. The whole Vukasinska wants to see from Bosnia, and there won't be even a minor, I would think, change in its position within Bosnia. Nor will the central government be able actually impose its will upon the Bundes, so it's our centralized policy. So essentially, all these EU campaigns will end in winter. So essentially, a status quo. So for once, and we are not doing that badly. This could be interpreted as a negative peace, but it's still better than violent conflict, I would think. This is, of course, because we already had this major reconfiguration of national states in the region of 25 years. So in a way, a consequence of this is that now there are no resources, nor the capacity among the political leaders to do anything about something that they want to do. And I would claim that much of this that they talked about is essentially about electioneering in Croatia and also in Bosnia, because if you look closely at what is going on in Bosnia these days, well, they would have local elections in the Republika Srpska in a few days' time. And it's not any local elections, but local elections that will kind of fix the starting position for the next election at the NFP level in the Republika Srpska. And the key parties are head to head. So in a way, it's essentially about elections. So in a way, we shouldn't be too worried, if you want. This is not about a major rise in extremism. It is something else which I think is also dangerous. But in a way, it grows into a much response. And it is in a way a reflection or a major trend that we've been seeing in the region of the Balkans and also in Central Europe, which is about the time in democracy. And we just got a conference, the annual conference of the Serbian Political Association, which discussed these sort of issues, whether we are seeing a decline or eclipse of democracy in groups and of democracies. And it seems to me that it's obvious that we have major decline in press freedom, major decline in space for opposition forces, including opposition parties, civil society associations, and organizations. So this is the effect that we are witnessing, together with the rise in journalism. So in that sense, I think we should perhaps focus more on our region, at least on these sort of events. Because if we lose democratic institutions, we won't have devices to actually oppose the rise of extremism if it happens at some point in time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. I think that those are great contributions and they're really right for discussion. I think that we can also have a verdict for Anthony Smith and say he was wrong in 1997. Now we see that. Whichever lens that we choose to use, and there are plenty of lenses that we are given for this discussion. The floor is yours.
Yeah. I want to direct some remarks to doctors Bakić and Tamás. But with the caveat that I do not agree with much of what's been said. Oh, thank you. I don't think our problem is authoritarian government. Rise of fascism, which is taking place in front of our noses, and which no one said anything about, I might mention, which is in Ukraine, is the best example, where we have a rebirth of the old World War II fascist movements, taking part in armed militias, blowing up power stations, other acts of violence of this sort, and we have a weak president, Poroshenko. And so this is the danger that I think I see coming into very violent in the country. Perhaps you might think about Croatia, which has this kind of mess. But this is the problem is not an authoritarian ruler, but the problem is the street gangs out. Karl Polanyi wrote about this in The Great Transformation. He saw this phenomenon come to be. He lost position. In Vienna, because of the Nazis. And then he had to migrate to England. So he knows, he's aware of how the gangs operate, how they dominate politics from the street. This is the problem in Ukraine. And I think we have to face up, well, they're debated, they disagree with me. Thank you.
Yes, and it's really strong. But
by directing the question to the other gentleman.
It would
be interesting to hear you both
on this. I could comment on briefly. I think that fascism is only extreme manifestation. Or if you like, we could differentiate between extreme and radical right. And we could differentiate between radicalism and extreme conservatism. So if we make such distinctions, then we could talk about Nazism as the most extreme, right? We could then talk about Italian type of fascism, which is a bit more left, but still at the extreme right pole. And we can talk about some specific fascisms in Spain during Franco regime or Salazar regime in Portugal. And we can talk about contemporary radical right, which wanted to make a distinction because of political correctness. They were clever enough to realize that it is not really a good thing to be recognized as a pure racist, open racist. And that is why they invented the doctrine of ethno-pluralism. So they took, no, we just don't want to mix with others. So if, for instance, an immigrant comes to our state, our society, we are not happy, especially if he or she is a Muslim. And that's the problem. Then Islam religion is just a cover for deeply rooted racism. Because usually Muslims are also different in material skin. It is recognizable in France, especially. It is recognizable in Germany. And regarding Ukraine, I think it's a bit more complicated than you said. Obviously, right sector is a Nazi group connected in ideological terms with Stepan Bandera. So it's quite obvious. And there is also some other extreme right groups, but Poroshenko is, I would say, just one of sad manifestations, one sad political manifestations in post-socialist world. One rich guy, authoritarian guy, who stepped into politics, and I think that it is very sad for Ukraine. I think that they made a big mistake. But I wouldn't say that the whole Poroshenko's or Arseniuk and others, that they are fascists. They are not.
Right,
that they are followers of Stepan Bandera.
Yes, indeed, please, I urge you to be realist in terms of historical evaluations. To use fascism from followers of Bandera today is not the same as Bandera himself. The right sector will write, these are both rights, they are following Bandera. But it's not fascism. Fascism was not about formation of the nation, it was about expansion of the nation. Whereas what is happening in Ukraine now is the finalization of nation formation process. They need symbols, and Petlura, Bandera, Ivan Franko, all of these guys are just, and what Ukraine is experiencing now is coming out of communism with the Minobot, with all of these change, radical changes of the urban space, eradication of Lenin monuments and so on and so forth. This is a divided country between the West and the East, with the East with a double identity, Ukrainian, Russian, and the West with a very strong Ukrainian identity. And the reference to Bandera does not mean that they are fascists in the same way as Bandera used to be and Cuba used to be during the Second World War. First of all, there are no more Germans, there are Russians on the other side. Second of all, Poland has no tanks, so it's not sending anyone in Ukraine, but it's sending a different way help. And then Germany is playing completely a different role in the Ukrainian scale than it used to play in the Second World War. To compare the two, it means to say that, I don't know, that Borko Stefanovic is Milosevic, but it's not the same. And I would want to say that Trump would be the same tough guy as Ronald Reagan. He's not going to be the same. The first was an actor, the second one is a dumb. It doesn't matter. This is why I don't agree with you, in the sense that you are labeling, you are using labels that are not explaining the situation in Ukraine. Definitely not. What is happening in Ukraine is an attack from one state, it's a game played elsewhere for influence, about influence between other major powers, and perhaps Ukraine will be the Spain of our today world. Perhaps, we never know that. We don't know that. We'll see.
I didn't want to say anything older, you invited me to, but I cannot leave this time. Come on. They may be not fascist, it's just a word. But the Ukrainian political life, not only the right sector, many other sectors, is full of pathological racist killers, and where the state is a murderous gang of nobodies, and with no clear aim apart from enriching themselves and making as many people unhappy as they can. It's really a terrible, terrible dumb. And that the West is defending the present Ukrainian regime against Russia, which compared to Ukraine is stable democracy. That's really, really, really a very blind thing. That's not the topic tonight, but I couldn't allow it. Okay, so you're quite right. Yes.
More hands. I mean, as if we didn't have enough diplomatic words, fascism kills us all, kills the discussion, I would say, not raises the discussion. I think we had maybe we should collect those three now and then.
If you knew me better, you would know that I don't need this microphone. Question for Ljubica, and if someone else cannot resist, then okay, because I think her sensibility is the best for this question. You said something about a joint European answer to this. Now, I'm wondering, desperate times need desperate measures. Are we now, or are we coming to the situation like the dilemma of the Weimar Germany? Should we limit our political space to those who challenge it? And if not, why not? If yes, then okay, you just say, but if not, why not?
Okay. Well, thank you very much for your presentation. So I just wanted to point one important contradiction when we talk about the role of the nation in the post war. I think the nation has become more appealing at the time when actually it's really meaningless. And the reason why it's meaningless is because of the existing global order, which is deeply hierarchical and unequal. So today we have a the dominance of capitalism in a very sinister version, such as financialization. We don't even speak about working class, working people, or production anymore. So if you go to London, you would realize that there are all these huge buildings where people work day and night, and what they do, no one knows actually, because most of the goods that are traded around the world go through London. So London really is not producing anything. But so why communication has become so big? I think because the left is non-existent, and the guys who are in the form of right-wing extremists, populist fascists, you name it, I think they use it to distract the opinion from the real problem that existed in the world. Take the UK. So the main motto was take back control and take back Britain. So this raises two questions. So who is taking back control and from whom? So basically it was from the European Union, but why? So today you have a new government in power, which is a pro-Brexit government. The first thing they did is to expand the Chinese investments in Britain. So you want to get rid of the European Union, but you want to bring Chinese money in the country. And then further invest in this logic of financialization by destroying completely any sort of production in Britain. Or I think that the other extreme case of Ireland with the European Court of Justice, which forced Google to pay 13 billion euros in taxes, and the Irish government appealed the decision. So they don't want the money back in taxes that Google didn't pay. So what kind of nation here? So we're talking about the dominance of global corporations, and I think that's the real problem. In the regional context, I think we have wars, we all know how it went, but I just recently came across one interesting financial data that all the financial capital in the countries, from Slovenia to all the way to Macedonia, so between 70% and 85% of capital is owned by foreign banks. So much about the idea of the nation, solidarity and redistribution. So I think to sum up, I think the nation has become really meaningless at this time of global domination by some international corporations. But I think, unfortunately, because there is no other alternative vision, transnational, progressive vision, I think it has become somehow appealing for people who are the main losers for this new world order. Thank you.
I think it was Ljubica, she spoke of the crimes of communism. I think communism is over, it's a fact, and it's capitalism. So actually, we need to speak of crimes of capitalism and freedom. Because I'm coming from Turkey, and all these discussions about extremism, it's so vivid in Turkey. So if you remember the EU supports extremist policies around the world, especially recently in Ukraine, in Syria, and in Turkey. Erdogan was supported by the EU, and most supporters were actually from the modern side, I mean from the center right and from the center left. Now for 3 years they are criticizing Erdogan, but they did actually support him. And while supporting him, they were actually criticizing nationalists, the revolutionaries, and socialists for being so backward-minded. So, I mean, if you're concerned about extremism, you should be concerned about extremism per se, not a peculiar type of extremism. Because in the invasions of Iraq, in Syria, Libya, Afghanistan, Pakistan, the outcome is so, I mean, must have been expected that these refugees or immigrants or migrants should actually ban all these areas in Europe. And the Islamic bombings, the Islamic attacks, or suicide attacks will increase because the people that are so desperate in their struggle because they left here, they lost their armies, began terrorism, they participated in terrorism. And some of these terrorists actually from the barbarian places or the ghettos of Europe, some of them are Christian and converted to Islam. So I mean, if you want to encourage the endorse and these anti-extremist policies. Actually, we should think of imperialist policies in the area, especially in the Middle East.
Thank you.
because the, all these extremist rise in Europe actually something to do with Islamist attacks and Islamist rebellions in Europe.
Try to briefly touch upon several points. I talked about perhaps a common European approach because in my mind history is very entangled and we can't approach history in any other way. So I think from that perspective, I mean, giving solutions or answers for the future as such is not possible in a very monolithic way. I believe in regional approaches, I believe in transnational networks, but again, being informed by historical events, there is a recent good book on Paris as the anti-imperial metropolis and the importance of Paris in the 1930s as this meeting point of all these anti-imperial third world leaders. So had it not been for this space where these people would converge and exchange opinions, etc., perhaps we wouldn't have had the decolonization process of the 1950s. So I believe in forging transnational, perhaps regional networks. And of course, we could never have a European solution to a problem. Because the moment we start again thinking about one country, it ties to another country. And this brings in Turkey, of course. I mean, where I come from, Macedonia, of course, is very close to Turkey. And the Turkish presence has increased in the Balkans, especially in Macedonia, Kosovo, and Bosnia. But you're right to say that European politics towards Turkey, I mean, Turkey has been a candidate country right since the 1970s, yet we know how this has been slowed down or etc. So, I think there is not one answer, but there really has to be grassroots solutions, which would eventually tie into a bigger network.
Since now that Dr. Vladisavljević raised the question of Scotland, I'd like to continue on that. In Scotland, of course, there was not a vote in favor of Brexit, but in favor of remaining. And also we saw that it was even higher in areas with working class population. So shouldn't we look to countries such as Scotland, and it's also happening in other states and nations in Europe, such as Catalonia, where center-left nationalist vision can be articulated without this extreme right and anti-immigrant or anti-migrant or anti-refugee discourses? Shouldn't we look to these issues where there is actually a center-left nationalist, air quotes, alternative? And this is for everybody in the world to answer.
I will bring questions. First, is the question about the meaning of Brexit. It seems to me sometimes that Brexit is a big question mark on the future of the European Union. And the question mark that questioned the really sad, deep intention of this political proper. The question is, what do you think that the meaning of political needs of Brexit, the long term perspective? Second question is connected with immigration crisis. My answer, my question is, if there is some kind of justification, raised justification of fear of the people, fear of the states. Because I think that states and people in these states have a right to to have all institutions, preserve the institutions of the states for themselves. Because, for example, Hungary state is a state of Hungary people. It's a statement from the constitution that, for example, Republic of Poland is a republic of citizens of Poland, not citizens of, for example, Alemania. I understand the humanitarian dimension of this immigration crisis, but the question is that numbers, huge numbers, for example, in comparison of the size of Hungary or the Czech Republic, the numbers, it's in my view sometimes, in the struggle of the small state to right to exist. Because, for example, 1 million immigrants in Deutschland, it is a big problem. But 1 million immigrants in Czech Republic, it is the finish of the state. As you know from the history. The question is about rational, not fascist, but rational basis of the people's view. And the third question is the last. We have in Europe some very amazing protests. On the one hand, we have the protest of Europeization, federal project of Europe as the United States of Europe. And another one, we have a project of emerging independence or of dialogue. Scottish coming referendum and a lot of small regions who have aspiration to be national state. I think that small states have a right to self-determination, but when we see in some small states which are economically don't exist without foreign aid, without donors, I sometimes feel in Belgrade, Jugoslavia problem. If I understand this project about connection of small nations, this big federation, which will be sufficient, will be able to exist as a state organized. And the question is, I don't know details about Yugoslavia history. And apologize if I have some important feeling of my host. But the question is, if the federation project, regional federation, not only here, but for example, in the Baltic state, when the Estonia and Litva have air force supported by America, by Polish, because the states are too small by this expensive instrument of military protection. And the question is that is a federation project, regional federation. It is maybe a good solution for small national institutions, small states. Thank you very much.
Big bits and pieces because we didn't get across the point. A little bit about Brexit, that was one of the questions. And it's unclear what kind of consequences such major events can produce, because there are always unintended consequences. You know, those conservatives who wanted a little bit less Europe, and that's why they supported the referendum, did not really want full secession, but they ended up with this. When Cameron actually agreed to have Scotland's independence referendum, he was thinking probably that he would easily contain this issue and sort it out for at least he probably could foresee the reactions that it would produce in England, in the majority nation. And this then can be translated into the tide of Brexit. Just 2 or 3 months before Brexit, most people believed that Remain would actually win, narrowly but still win. And very quickly this changed. And it's unclear what kind of unintended consequences will happen, having in mind the internal EU relationship. What has happened is major uncertainty. And once you have this sort of uncertainty, then you know, many things that were seen as impossible just recently, just a few months ago or years ago, may actually be very seriously considered. And you know, think about how we thought about European Union just a few years ago. And now all these things that seem impossible are very seriously considered by key political actors within Europe and outside of Europe. Now, there was also a question, when it comes to Brexit, I think that one of the key problems there is actually the use of referendum. These devices are very crude. These are majoritarian devices that produce polarization. And look at Scotland, look at the United Kingdom, and look at the former Yugoslavia. I mean, these sort of referenda, in a way, helped trigger war in the UK, within a particular context, of course. And we still have them in the region. So they are very dangerous, especially in divided societies. So we need actually something very different. We need power sharing. We need complex institutions that can bring different groups together, providing autonomy, participation. Also, veto powers. They may not be extremely effective in terms of producing good results, but they actually will prevent conflict and violence. So in a way, faster we move away from such cruel political devices as the agenda, better and better for all of us.
Okay, pray for us. There will be a referendum in Hungary on the 2nd of October. The government is asking a question. Do you want the European Union to move immigrants in this country without the approval of our parliament? And tens of billions have been spent on government propaganda and atmosphere, you can imagine the atmosphere. If I call it poisoned, I was very polite. But getting back to, well, this is really tragedy for my country, but at the same time, of course, the terms in which these cows are ridiculous. So what I wanted to say to the gentleman who sat in the first row here and behind there, raised the most interesting and most important problem. Of course, you know, all those people are now joining anti-political such as ethnicist forces or even the extreme rights, etc., 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 have reasons for such behavior. And the anger and the despair of many people felt because of the well-known phenomena of deindustrialization, you know, when it really life in capitalism and in modern society in general has been shaped around work. The workplace, the profession, the trade, the craft has been one of the most important identifying tools in society. Very many people were identified with, you know, being good craftsmen one way or another. It's even penetrated in the intellectual realm, where everybody is now a professional and academic. So, you know, all these elements of identity, very important, civic and political identity too, locality, profession, occupation, you know, where you live, the life force, all shaped by going to work and then being at leisure. This dichotomy, this everyday dichotomy of life and modernity is absolutely crucial. And now it is being destroyed. Now it's being destroyed because so many people cannot work or have some sort of replacement for work. Some God knows how these people will live. And you see, at the same time, the world is full of non-investment money. It's really, you know, the banks have fantastic amounts of improductive money. You know, the situation of everybody could be easily improved, and technological changes and organizational changes needed to adapt work to this new digital and robotized and automatized era could be possible, but nothing is moving, and no political force is indeed wanting to reform. So the hatred of the establishment is perfectly legitimate, it's perfectly understandable. People have very good reasons hating the establishment and thinking about European Union, but it's an ineffective nothing. Well, that's an exaggeration. And of course, now that the European Union is going to the dogs, and you know, I never liked it, but now, you know, with the benefit of hindsight, you know, it appears as distinctly the lesser evil. You know, there were a few years before, I must confess now, that when I came to ex-Yugoslavia and especially Serbia, you know, many people were saying that their aspiration was to join the European Union. And I said before, you know, what? Is that an aspiration? Where do you want to go? It's banal, boring, insignificant, nothing. What was an aspiration? Now I know that you won't be able to get into the European Union because it won't exist. And at least not in the form that attracted the Balkan peoples. It's done. And we Europeans can be proud to have played an important role in that. And especially my country has been the flag bearer of every nonsense that you can imagine. And but the consequences are most terrible. So it is true that Trump voters and Brexiteers and Le Pen voters have a lot of good arguments against. But however much their anger and despair is legitimate, we shouldn't acknowledge that because that would be unfair. The consequences are all the same, terrible. Wasn't Hitler right when he protested against the injustice of the Versailles peace treaty? He was perfectly right. Was he not right when he said that the international bank was suffocating Germany? Wasn't, you know, he right when he said that the Western powers won't allow, you know, Germany to arm and they are armed to the teeth, that this is unfair against the great country? So, you know, we don't remember Hitler by having been right. Okay, that is really a detail in his his political makeup and his political biography and the fate of the German mission and of Europe and the whole world. So, you know, we have to keep indeed a balance and be fair and polite to people who have very good reasons to rebel in this way. But at the same time, and it's not easy, at the same time, we should remain steadfast. I don't think you said that some people might think about this authoritarian and dictatorial development that this is nothing. I haven't met anybody to think that nothing, but I've met many people who think that it's wonderful. You know, a few people think it's awful, but you don't have, for example, in Hungary where every day an important American institution disappears, or that every week, let's go to Exeter, and every 5 days. But it's not the case that people are totally apathetic. No. Many people, especially people on the right, are actually enthusiastically endorsing this. Think, for example, the traditional democratic administration is bad. So that we have no administration in this place, that's very interesting, that's a well-known consequence of dictatorship, chaos, total chaos, total disorder. And so people might not like the consequences, but when, you know, the 1989, used 80 date in Hungarian history, 1989, that's really, you know, if you want to inflame an audience, just say regime change and everybody will be ready to beat you up. And, you know, that's, you know, 90% of people declare that it was better than socialism, especially right-wing voters. And, you know, and so you see, at the same time, you have to remain steadfast in defense of boring world institutions such as press freedom, etc., etc. And it's a difficult exercise because we too, who are defending these, are angry.
What a dark picture we have pictured. Really, are you going to sleep tonight? Are we going to sleep tonight? All these bad. No. I'm going to sleep actually. You know, just to ask a simple question, I mean, is European Union responsible for what is happening in Hungary? It's not. You don't take the dream out. I remember when we were shouting, we want our country to be in Europe. I said that. I said that. Yes, Viktor Orban said that in 1989, but then he shifted. It's not my fault that Viktor Orban said that. Yes, but it's the problem with Viktor Orban and the European Union. That's my point. It's that, let's not mix the two. Probably, the European Union will react with Viktor Orban in the same way as it's reacting with other smaller or bigger organs. They're just going to be marginalized. It is already marginalized. And that's why Viktor Orban is so much happy Vladimir Putin, to whom I know, I don't remember, I don't understand this love between the two. That's my point. So, in the sense that okay, there are dangers, there are problems, definitely there are. But let's not forget that there are also good solutions that are being used and are there. It's not like everything is getting towards the, we are told to get into extremism, fascism, or whatsoever. Because otherwise, why leave you? Let us be Choran and then kill us.
Mr. Gallagher, do you have some positive, optimistic question?
The right sector is the shock troops for austerity. Yatsenyuk and the government are trying to impose terrible austerity on the elderly and on the youth in Ukraine, cutting pensions drastically, causing tremendous unemployment. And the right sector is what enables them to get away with, because they will beat you up if you oppose government policy.
The right sector in Ukraine has two big units. This is Battalion Azov and Battalion Donbas. The first Battalion Azov defended Mariupol, which made it difficult for the Russian army to get near Kiev. The second Battalion defended Odessa from the Ukrainian point of view and state of Ukraine, territoriality, whatever we call it. It's sort of a victory, in my opinion. That's very simple.
Mine is a very short comment. We've been talking about the European Union, and I think that the European Union has been employed, or we have been exposed to an instrumental view of the European Union. I would say the European Union was not problematic when people took the money, that the European Union was distributed kindly, and, you know, suddenly the love that emerged in the first months, so when the European Union actually worked, turned into a terrible situation and lots of criticism that we are hearing now. So I think that there is something that should be revising here, because the current actions don't quite match with that position.
Unfortunately, we're at the end of our conversation, and while it's important, it cannot only begin the conversation, as it probably should be, the conversation about these very ticklish issues. I wanted to say that I was thinking all along that now the full name of this conversation is the return of the national borders and the rise of extremism in Europe. I'm thinking that 5 years ago, not to speak about 10 or 15 years ago, to talk about the return of the nation state in Serbia would be almost ridiculous. That is the first thing. Obviously, we're talking about Europe and European Union, and that's why Ljubica's approach, her call for a common approach to the European question, I think it would make sense as sort of the conclusion of this conversation of ours. And the other thing that I want to say is that talking about nationalism, especially in the conference that is founded on the background of Serbian-Albanian relations, and that maybe the most prominent words that was amongst us, of course we have disagreements about lots of things, democracy, extremism, nationalism, spatialism, that in the end, but the most prominent word was basically capitalism, I would say. How come that 5 years ago or 10 years ago that word was so much missing from our conversations? Is it maybe that the thing that we're now discussing, is it not nationalism, but ethnicism, and ethno-pluralism, and there was one more ethnocracy, that all of these came up maybe because we're so weak in our own bodies about thinking about nationalism and nation states for such a long period of time without being able to discern capitalism all along. If you would like to have a final round, maybe if this incites some ideas, and then, No, then let's call this a draw. Thank you very much.